I'm Okay, so same with me. Well, we were just giving you a chance to, I don't know what it's called, but gather together like this. Pretty quiet in this room. You know, usually when you get together, there's everybody talking until I stand up, and then you get quiet. You started off quiet. So. Anyway, on behalf of all of you, Jeanne's family, thank you for being here today. We're here to celebrate her life. 95 years, that's a long time, and a very elegant lady. She was full of accomplishments. She lived with an example for us. Now, that example doesn't always have to be positive. I've learned a lot of things from people. I don't want to be like that. But no, she was a lovely lady and really very independent. She was a woman who always wanted to be in control of the things that were going on and wanted to be listened to and wanted to be needed, wanted to be a part. Isn't that the way the human spirit really is? Oh, it really is. And you are all a part of her life, and you're here to honor her today. And she loves you as much as you love her. I need you to do me a favor. I did a service this morning, and I asked everybody to do this. Pull your phone out, and I don't care if you think you did it already or not, because I'm in the middle of a service, and this guy's phone goes off. So pull your phone out and either double-check it or something, but make sure it's on silence. I do that as well. So, thank you. Join me in prayer, please. Lord, I know that when we come to these places like this, well, first off, my mind goes to you and the graciousness that you have to give us breath and life. But when we come here, our hearts are heavy. And yet, at 95 years, we want to celebrate. We want to rejoice. We want to laugh with gratitude and holiness and blessings. And we want to, our tears are weeping to be our for ourselves because Jeanne will no longer be in our life from day to day. We can't call her. People visit her. And those are the things that really touch us the most. All our lives, we were deeply touched with her energy, her expertise, yes, Lord, thank you for that, and her love. Lord, you blessed her with many gifts. I think two of them are not so much with her hands, but with her heart, determination and independence. And those you blessed her with, that she utilized a great deal to bring about the most happiness she could find in life. You also gave her the ability to talk to anyone. I remember the first time we met and the conversation we had and how it was an easy conversation, as if we'd known each other for a long time. Lord, she used these gifts make a difference in the lives of so many people. And we focus on the positive here today, and we thank you for the whole package. We praise your Father for her and Jesus. Jeanne Ellyn Kerr-Biehler passed away December 2nd, 2023 in Emmett, Idaho. She was born November 17th, 1928 in
Lookeba.
That's the way you would say it. Lookeba.
It's Lookeba.
I believe it. Oklahoma. To Snow Burdsall Kerr and Isabelle V. Stroud-Kerr. During the Great Depression, the small family of three moved to the farm close to Omega, Oklahoma, and during the land run of 1889. That's history. You hear this lady who's just now leaving us. E.C. Kerr, Snoker's father, made the run and staked his claim in that land run to 160 acres of land. It was desirable land, having a creek providing water for horses and cows. Jeanne Ellyn was an only child until her dear brother Larry came along 10 years later in August of 38. Being alone until Larry arrived, Jeanne was used to roaming the countryside. There was watermelon patch on the land, which enabled Jeanne to pick a ripe one and cool it off in the close by creek. And then not having a knife, or maybe she did, but just dropping it and eating off the pieces. Until the day of her demise, Jeanne loved the taste of watermelon. Oh good, I'm glad everybody else is going to She graduated from Omega High School during the fall of 1946. She enrolled in college at Stillwater, Oklahoma. The following summer, she met James Jason Merrill, and they were married on December 23rd, 1948. Their daughter, Karen, was born March 4th, 1949. Yeah, I was doing the math.
Yeah, I think she did a typo. I think it was supposed to be
47. Oh, well, that's what we'll put that in there. Yeah. And the marriage didn't survive and ended in divorce. I'm sorry. Jeanne Ellyn and John Baylor were joined in marriage on January 15, 1950, and their marriage was happy and lasted for 57 years until John's. During the early years of John and Jeanne's marriage, it was difficult to make a living on a rented farm ground. So this prompted Jeanne to enter college at Weatherford, Oklahoma, where she received her Bachelor of Science degree in 1958. After graduating, she taught school in Lacey, Loyal, and Kingfisher, Oklahoma. Teaching wages in Oklahoma were low, and the family of three moved to Beaumont, California in January of 1964. And her daughter Karen enrolled in the Beaumont school system where she graduated from high school in 1967. During the summer vacation, Jeanne attended Northern Arizona University, where she received a Master's of Art degree in 1968. During the time, Jeanne attended NAU. Dr. Foster, an education specialist, arranged a trip to visit Russian schools. The highlight of the trip was a visit to the Hermitage, also known as the Palace of Catherine the Great, which is in St. Petersburg, Russia. Its magnificence is beyond description, and within it are paintings by some of the world's greatest artists. Jeanne spent 25 years in the teaching field. One of the greatest yet humbling statements was made to Jeanne when she was undergoing treatment in a local hospital. I have to say she doesn't have for what here?
I have no idea.
A former student was approximately 25 years old and approached Jeanne and said, "Miss Baylor, I have used during my adult lifetime all of the business skills that you taught me. Isn't that a great compliment for the teacher?" Following her teaching career, Jeanne traveled to various countries with her friend Vanetta Kell. Jeanne and John resided in Banning, California for numerous years. While Karen was still at home, the three enjoyed exploring the mountain trails of Mount San Gorgonio, thank you, and San Jacinto, riding their dirt bikes. Can you picture Karen on a dirt bike?
I've seen the pictures.
Yeah. Meadowview in Emmett, Idaho became Jeanne's home in her later years. Living in Emmett allowed Jeanne to become even closer to her lovely family. How precious they are. The good Lord has blessed me with my wonderful daughter, Karen, and her precious family. May the good Lord keep them safe from all harm. Jeanne was preceded in death by her parents, her husband, and great-grandson, Jay's daughter. She's survived by her daughter, Karen, and her husband, John Keenitz, grandchildren, Beth and Grant Carter, Amy and John D. Durbin, and Chris and Sarah House Keenitz. Great-grandchildren are Jordan, Rose, Devin, Tyler, and Newman's great nieces and nephews. No grandchildren.
five generations.
Wow. Celebration of life, and so a little laughter is okay, and thoughts like that, I think that's what Jeanne would enjoy the most. You know, she lived a long life, 95 years old. I tried to picture the differences between 1928 and 2023, and what has taken place. And my first thought was go to automobiles. You know, of course, when you're born in 1928, you don't remember anything. 35 or 34 or something like that, but automobiles were just, the Model A and things like that, and their speed limit was maybe 30, and now we have an interstate with 85. They didn't have television, and now we have internet, instantaneous messaging across the world, and what a difference, what a life change she experienced. And all through the 95 years, right up really to the very end, she was active in all of it, and aware of all of it, and intelligent in all of it. As we heard, she was born during the Depression, and by the time she was old enough to understand, the effects of the Depression were still very much felt. All her life, the effects of the Depression were pretty much felt. You used everything. My grandmother used to say, when they butchered a pig, we used everything but the squeal. And so I can imagine that's what Jeanne experienced as well. Because her father was a farmer, And like many during those years, they were able to sustain their own needs on the farm. Meager needs. They didn't have a lot of lavish things, but they were able to take care of themselves. And they relied on each other. Everybody had a task. From a young girl, she developed those skills that she was given. I'm assuming, I don't know for sure, but you know, things like a little girl collecting the eggs, or feeding the chickens, or the different aspects of chores that are really important, because if you didn't get it done, it didn't get done. And so everybody, it wasn't just a training session, it was a necessity. And so she learned independence and responsibility. She loved to learn. All her life, learning was, she was voracious in that, in reading and everything. And through that, she grew to love to teach. And for much more than 25 years she spent in the classroom, she did both, learn and teach. She loved kids and loved being involved in the community. And after that, we could spend the next 2 or 3 hours talking about some of those things that she did in the community. She was widely volunteering and helping and wanted to be out and about. She was a lifelong member of the Methodist Church and was proud of this. I guess you could say that in her 95 years of life, she crammed 200 years of experience, of fun. Like so many awards that she had, many of them still on the wall in her apartment at Meadowview. I noticed one the other day was Woman of the Year for Banning, California. Now you would think a woman born in 1928, that might be in the 70s or the 80s, 2004, 2005, Woman of the Year. She was active into age. She was an accomplished woman, and her deepest desire was really to help others also be accomplished. So with that, she wasn't always easy. You know, when you're an accomplished person and you want others to be accomplished, sometimes you write them pretty hard, and she had a reputation for doing that, but all for your use, for you to be the best you could be. Even the last few years while living at Meadowview, which she thoroughly enjoyed, she really did, she had many friends. They would play cards, and she could play anything, but she taught them how to play a game that none of them had played before called 13. And during that card session every day or whatever, they'd laugh, they'd scream, they'd throw cards down, they'd holler at each other, you know. Dora and Gail were two of her regulars. Are they here today? Dora and Gail? You were two of her regulars, so correct me if I'm wrong, okay? But I know all of you are going to miss her very much. And I know there was a gentleman that would sometimes get down and play with you as well. And he was very competitive and did not like to lose. And neither did Jeanne. So the two of them would go at it. And I understand the two of you just sat back and laughed. Good. One of the things that Karen was telling me just a few moments ago was that as she was living in Meadowview and getting on up in years, 95 years old, finally came the time for Karen to go and take her key car keys away from her. And so she came into the apartment where Jeanne was staying there, and went, walked right in, said, "Hi, Mom," went right back to the bedroom, started looking, and Jeanne jumped out of the chair. Okay, maybe for her it was jump. And out of the chair, and she, "What are you doing?" "Oh, I'm just looking." And finally Karen found the keys, and it was a very difficult time for both of them to do that. Little did Karen know until later, her and Amy were going through some of the things after Jeanne passed, and found another set of keys. She had called, after Karen went in and got those keys from her, she had called a locksmith in Garden City to come over and make a new set of keys for her car. I don't know whether she ever used them or not, but that's that determination and independence that she lived all her life. I last saw Jeanne at her great-granddaughter Rose's wedding that I performed this summer. She was her normal self, elegant, and although she was quiet, really, that day, because she was elegant. You know, I enjoy a woman like Jeanne, who is beautiful, as you see here, in all dolled up. But she can wear a pair of jeans and t-shirt and look like $1 million. Mm-hmm. So she was very comfortable and enjoyed that too. I'm going to read something from her granddaughter, Beth. Driven, determined, strong, independent, those are words that describe my grandmother. Throw in a splash of stubborn also. Here are some stories and her memories of our ventures. Some do include my siblings, so those of you who are here, you might not have experienced that specific thing, but it will cause you to think of the times she did something similar with you. Hi, Grandma. Well, it's Bethy. Yeah, that's what your name is from here on out. Well, it's Bethy. What are you up to, my love? Was her greeting to me when visiting, and we would chat about whatever was happening. Amy and I learned how to play blackjack from her and Grandpa John. A roll of pennies, a deck of cards, and lots of learning. We had to earn those pennies. At times I'd grab a deck and play myself to be sharp. I have to learn to read again, I guess. At times I grab a deck and play myself to be sharp and see how I would be. I learned from the best and could have been accused of cheating while playing with other people. That sound familiar, Dale? You're cheating. When Grandpa John died, we were in Oklahoma for the services, and I put a deck of blackjack cards in his suit coat pocket. She said, "You can't do that. Why not?" Thank you for scratching my head.
Grant made me do it.
Thank you, Grant. The heck I can, is my reply. The next visit to California, she gave me a deck of bridge cards and says, "When I die, put these in my casket." Well, Grandma, they're there. One summer, Amy and I were at Silent Valley for a week or so, staying in the motorhome. Well, there was a neighborhood raccoon, and we couldn't go out. So between the three of us, we came up with a plan. Grab a slice of bread, throw it across our sight, and then we could get out. The throw happened, and it only fell at the bottom of the step. The raccoon did finally go away, but we played pool, cards, swam, and had great times inside the valley. We would drive there for holidays, leave here like 9 or 10 p.m. at night, fuel in Winnemucca, then Bishop, California, and stop at Schatz. I knew the recipe, don't I? Never been out of it. His bakery. Hit both sets of grandparents by lunchtime. Mom and Dad were probably exhausted by trading driving, but we made it. As us kids got older, we know 395 South very well. Grandma had white carpet and furniture in her home.
Don't worry, we did that too.
In my opinion, it should be absolutely against the law for carpet to be white. Shoes were off and was almost intimidated by it. I have that color in our home, and trust me.
It's going to be changed soon.
Trust me, it's going to be changed in the distant future. It was fun to visit her in my adult years. I would fly Southwest Airlines down with two large suitcases and a carry-on. Typical woman. Well, Grandma didn't live too far from the Cabazon Outlet Mall. I scored some great items over time from there. At times, we went to the buffet at Morongo Casino, talked about overfood overload. What about the blackjack table?
Then you stopped
at Hadley's for a date shake. They are always so good. And when visiting our grandparents in Southern California, Cabazon and Hadley's were a treat. Grandma would host bridge parties, her PEO ladies, banning women's club and friends, overtime at the home, all of them. And then the food oddities would come out. I don't remember them all, but they were really weird. Grandma had a great friend, Jeanne. Both of them named Jeanne?
Okay.
Grandma had a friend, Jeanne, and were both widows, and they would have sleepovers and watch movies and drink wine. They were always up to something. Jeanne left her overnight bag in the back bedroom closet so that she could come back the next night or whatever. Speaking of the back bedroom, the bed was horribly uncomfortable. I know my dad was thrilled to see that bed go when she moved to Idaho. I was visiting Grandma in February of 2018, and Jeanne had a medical emergency. We raced over to her home the next day, but Jeanne didn't want to bother us because I was visiting. Grandma can drive Betsy, her car. Grandma can drive her car, Betsy, pretty darn fast, and I will attest to that. Try following her in my rental car. Well, an ambulance and firemen showed up because of her emergency. She didn't want to be the talk of the neighborhood, but when they showed up, guess which two ladies were flirts? I haven't read this before, so it's the first time through it, and I'm just laughing with you. Jeanne did pass away not long after that, and I told Grandma, I'm so thankful I was there to be with her at that time. Mom was on the phone and listening with an ear of comfort. As Grandma started to age some, her health issues were on our minds. We were 850 miles away. During corn harvest in October of 2014, she had a pacemaker failure. Mom and I flew down there and were with her. She had initial complications in Redlands and was transferred to Good Samaritan in downtown LA on Friday night. I have never driven in LA, much less through Tent City. Let me tell you, lots of looking forward while driving and praying. Took the wrong exit in a very, very sketchy part of LA, made it to the hospital, and Grandma was settled for the time. Mom and I had a weekend of adventures in L.A., all the stories we can tell. Those are secret. What happens in L.A. stays in L.A. The medical staff fixed the issue, and we got her home. They also recommended some great restaurants there. La Paria, Mexican food was one, and back in the day was Charlie Chaplin's home. Had a history lesson while we were there. Wilshire Boulevard is named after him. I screwed up while on that trip. When at Grandma's home and the Democratic National Party called asking for monetary donations. This is where I screwed up and didn't tell them she was unhappy with their decisions. She was a diehard Democrat, but this granddaughter did talk politics with her. At times, we did differ, but did agree on several things, too. When she moved to Idaho, I will say I got her to vote heavily Republican. All the questions running through my mind. She was a fan of Mr. Trump and his antics. Some I don't like either. She was not a fan of Trump and his antics. But I told her what I would do for her. For cheap fuel and more money in my pocket, I'd go for it. Yeah. She couldn't disagree with that. When Grant had to travel for work to Southern California, he would try and spend a day or a half a day with her when she still lived down there. They had many good conversations about many items, investing, stock market, life. I know he enjoys the visits they have had over time, and she would introduce him as her grandson. Grandma had some type of stroke, or TIA, in June 2018. Mom and I were on the Southwest flight down here. Funny thing is, at that time, I knew all the flights to Southern California on Thursdays to get to her. The medical journey starting her trip to Idaho. As her brother Larry said, there are more of you there to take care of her than here. After many discussions figuring out how to get her here, all the stars aligned, and she came to Idaho in July 2018. She became a resident of Meadowview Assisted Living, and our cargo trailer brought many of her items from home to make it comfortable for her. Grandma was resistant at first for a while, but then started making new friends. Card games, I guess she had everyone, or most everyone, at time playing cards in the afternoon or after dinner. Can you sense a thing here with her cards? I no longer remember many card games from being a girl and watching them play pitch. I would go to Costco runs for Grandma and get toilet paper and Kleenex. She has gone through more toilet paper than any person I know. I would make her go look then and tell her how much she had so I wasn't in a mad rush. Right before my last trip, she was had 18 rolls that she had and wouldn't last while I was gone. You know, Bethy, toilet paper doesn't spoil. Just pick me up one when you go to Costco. Boy, my trips to Costco will change now. We would go to the doctor's appointments in Betsy together. Bethy, we need to clean the dust off her. She needs to run. That's called pedal to the metal. And oh, Grandma, the adventures we had. If you were not there at the time you said she was in Betsy, wait, or would already be driving herself over. We didn't dare let her drive over the hill. That's a disaster waiting to happen. So after her appointment, we would go to Roanne's for a cherry spin and pick up something for the boy. She would meet Grant. Then we could be found at La Costa for food and Corona or a margarita to wash it down. At times, she didn't like the food at Meadowview, and her and her lady friends would load up in Betsy and head to Roanne's. I don't know how many times they did that. My guess is it's a secret. How did you stay so thin? It was fun to show Grandma our barn camera and cattle. Barn camera. You mean you had a camera in the barn and it watched the cows? It was fun. Okay.
His name was God.
The name was.
His name was God. Yeah, barn camera's named God.
Okay, watching over everything. Good. Our last calf born, We were sitting at the pulpit, and Ruby, the cow, was pacing. After our heifer was born with people assistance, Grandma asked if I named her. Well, not yet, but her mom's name is Ruby. Grandma says the heifer needs to be named Diamond. Grandma, Diamond is doing great. I nailed her photo so that she could pull up on your computer. She loved the Lord along with her family and often said, that John Keenitz and Grant are just fine men, like my John, her John. Some of our recent conversations, we talked about trust. The sometime items were pinky swear, and it was between us. Oh, Grandma, it's all good with me. Trust. I was going to Hawaii earlier this year, but my trip was postponed. Grandma asked me the week before she passed if she could go. Grandma, let's go. Well, I flew Saturday the 2nd, and she passed not long after I landed. I told her my worries will wash away with the ocean. Bethy, you can't have any worries at your age. I know you're at peace and made it to heaven because the rainbows I saw last week showed me. You'll have to say that in quiet. I will come and speak for him.
Abuhiho.
Until we meet again. Very nice. It's hard to put 95 years into just a few minutes that we have here today. And I'm glad that Bethy ended her story with Jeannie's faith. Faith is an interesting thing. There are some people that think in order to have faith, you've got to be going like this, or like this, or something all the time. But faith is living your life out in every aspect, knowing that God is right next to you, right by your side. It's the purpose in our life. And Jeannie understood that importance. Faith is not just a given. I can't just say I have faith. Faith is a verb. I have faith. That means I live it. It's seen by others. It's almost like saying I have chicken pox, everybody see it or something. You see it. It's something that needs to be so important to us that others can see it. It's a deliberate aspect of our life. When we say we believe in Jesus, that belief is to be active. An aspect of everything we do. It's exercised and people see it. We notice it because our spirit shows it in those nine characteristics that are about faith, about Holy Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. When others look at us and they hear us say, I believe in Jesus, they should also see those nine qualities. We don't do these things to get saved. We do these good things because we are saved. Thank you, Jesus. The Bible is our teacher. And what these qualities do in our life is our guide. The path helps us to know what God and Jesus have done for us and also expect us to do for them. We've all heard of the Ten Commandments. And they help us live our lives for the Lord. Jesus said that these Ten Commandments can be narrowed down to two. So you don't have to memorize all ten. He said they're narrowed down to two. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. This relationship. And love your neighbor as yourself. This relationship. Jeannie has finished her race. That's the metaphor the Bible calls life. It's a race. I announced track meets at the high school here for both high school and junior high. And I like that analogy because I've gotten to see it firsthand. There may be 15, 20 people in the race. And there's always one, in those longer races especially, that maybe laps. The first guy laps the last guy at least. But when that last person, everybody else is done with their race, that last person come around that last corner, that last time, and it's fun. They can't win a thing. There's no prize other than satisfaction. And they pick up the pace and they run that last 100 yards with everything they've got. That's why the Bible uses the word race. That life is a race. Finish it. Everything you've got. It's meant to be that way. So today, we celebrate your life. Thank you for running the race. And even though there are times, like all of us, you got distracted, you got detoured, you took a break now and then. When you came around that last corner, you had the last 100 yards to go, you picked up. Celebrate Christmas this year. I know there will be that hole in your life, that void of not having her there. I pray it's still filled with memories like that you shared with us. God bless you. This is the moment I think we've dreaded the most, that final thought, Lord. And yet, as we come to that moment, I know that you are here and you are faithful. And you have your arms wrapped around us, comforting our heavy, broken hearts. 95 years is a long time, and what a joy to have had a parent and a friend for so long. So I just praise you for that. But in the days ahead, especially with the holidays coming, and the idea of calling, visiting, and all the things that go with that, and that hole that will be there, I ask you to be with this family and her friend. To fill that hole with wonderful memories of the laughter, the screaming, and the dusting off but Betsy. Father, those days would be great. We appreciate that. Thank you, Father. Please. Before we play this last song, after this is all said and done, when the song ends, we'll conclude our service, and you're more than welcome to sit and visit as long as you'd like. It's immediately after this, all of you are invited to come over to Meadowview at the dining hall area. There will be a small reception or a gathering, and we can just enjoy some refreshments and continue our talking about this wonderful lady and about what's going on in your life, in your own kids and grandkids. So I appreciate it. does include our services, you're more than welcome to stay and visit as long as you like.